back together separately.
Are we skipping everything?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
In a need answers to the questions that we have. How will we heal the world of this pandemic? How will we heal the nation of our unrest? What are we supposed to do? Some of y'all have heard me talk before, and you know that the only thing I'm any good at is telling stories. And I only have 4 or 5 stories, and this is one of them. I hope you haven't heard it already. My wife tells me that every time I tell a story, I should start with, I was born on a Sunday, and just go from there. I was born on a Sunday. When I was 15 years old, I was a counselor at a camp session in Mississippi for people with mental and physical disabilities, and it left a mark. It left a mark that's still on me. The call to treat all people with dignity and respect, not just the people that are like me, but all of God's children. So I went off to college and I went off to seminary, and when I came back, I worked at that same session at that same camp. And in 1983, a long time ago, I was asked to be the director of that session at Camp Bradley Green. I wanted to do it just right, which meant, you know, the way we'd always done it. In 85 or 86 or something, I felt like I knew what I was doing. That's usually when I get in trouble, when I feel like I know what I'm doing. And I've accepted sort of the rhythm of the camp day. Camp for people with disabilities, is like camp for everybody. The pace is a little bit different. We have music and skits and games and go fishing and go swimming and arts and crafts and canteen, all that stuff. At the end of the day, after everybody's had a big full day and now we're all in the chapel together and we've said our prayers, we've sung our songs, the last duty of the director is to tell people goodnight. It's time to go to the cabins. We have a big day today. Tomorrow we have even more fun. Y'all get lots of rest. Remember to take your medications. It's time for milk and cookies. Good night. Good night. In that holy, sacred moment, as I was watching all the campers go to the back of the chapel and up the hill to the dining hall to get milk and cookies, a sacrament, a special session. One of the campers came up with something to say. He was Glenn Tucker, a very athletic, high-functioning, good guy, an African-American young man from Greenville, Mississippi. He was especially good at kickball and softball, so we called him Slugger. He called me Mr. Keys. I'm not sure why, but he always called me Mr. Keys. He came up. I said, "Hey, Slugger," he said, "Mr. Keys, I want to know if I can go back behind the chapel and smooch with my girlfriend." And I said, "No. Surely you can't just allow a special session camper, this man with some intellectual difficulties, to just go off in the dark and smooch. I've never seen a rule written down about that kind of stuff, but surely you just can't do that." I said, "No, Glenn, that's against the rules." Just made it up on the spot. And I said, "And if you do that, you'll miss building cookies." Glenn Tucker said, "Mr. Keys, I'm 30 years old. I won't know darn milk and cookies." Counselors do. And I had been a counselor. And I knew that behind the chapel was the place to go for that sort of thing. So he had been hearing some counselors talk about their exploits. But still, you can't just let a mentally handicapped man and his similarly disabled girlfriend just go smooch said no. And I watched him walk away from me and find the young lady in question. And he was sort of explaining to her like this. And she was very animated. And after a while, I heard the police have her back. To make his appeal. And I'm trying to invent policies and rules on the spot that don't really exist. And he told me one of the most precious things I've ever been told by another human being. He came up, he had a tear coming down his eye. He came up and said, Mr. Keats, you could be wrong.
what we hold, it's about what we believe. We had a little bit more conversation. He wasn't buying anything that I was putting out there, and eventually he stood up and left his plate of lasagna, and the really pretty young woman that he was there with walked out and slammed the door. The rest of the evening, all of the students were reassuring me that it wasn't my fault. He was kind of a jerk anyway. I didn't feel like I failed that guy. A few years after that, we moved to St. Thomas in Huntsville, Alabama. And one day when I was in the office, the phone rang, the volunteer secretary answered the phone, and I heard her say, "Yes, he's here, just a moment." She told me who was calling. I didn't recognize the name. I picked up the phone. It took us a few minutes to figure out that he was the kid who left the lasagna and the pretty girl because he was upset with what I had said. I said, "How are you?" Wondering why in the world he is calling me. And he said his mother had died a couple of days before that. He wanted to know that she was okay. I said, "I believe that your mother is fine. I believe that God loves all of the children of God all the time, no matter what, forever. And I believe that her eternal soul, which is what has made her who she is all this time, is now in the communion of saints and fellowship with Jesus." And he said, "Do you know that to be true?" I said, "That's what I believe." He said, "Do you know it?" I said, "I hope it. I believe it. I'm betting my life on it." And he said, "I need to know." Here we are in days of unrest. And a virus has infected the whole world. And we have become more aware in the last couple of years how deeply racism colors our society and our lives. We like it better when we have the illusion that we're in control. We like it better when we believe the myth that we are the masters of our own fate. And we don't like it when we realize that that's never been true. And we have a hard time admitting that we don't know what's going to happen. And we have never been the masters of our own fate. Even our very lives are a gift that our Lord has given us. And every day is a blessing. Our faith, Christianity, is not now, has never been, and never should be about what we know. We can't reduce God so small that we can understand God. And the world is not limited to our imagination. So what we have, brothers and sisters, is what we believe, what we hope, what we are betting our lives on, that God is love, And God made the world as it is and looked down on it and said, this is good. Even with the snake in the garden, even with the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, God looked at what God had made and said, this is good. I know this is kind of going on a little bit. I want to go a little bit longer than the reading from Genesis. That's my goal. That's my heart. I'm a loop there. I don't know who asked you to do the Old Testament and who asked somebody else to do the New Testament. Boy, you got off easy. Before I went to seminary, I worked for the Mississippi Deaf and Blind Program. I was a parent educator for people who were deaf and blind, or deaf and another disability and blind and another disability. I traveled the whole north part of Mississippi. A lot of times I'd be coming back at night in my 1971 Mercury Comet, which had an AM radio which would pick up big, strong stations but nothing much else. And the main one that I listened to was out of Memphis. They played country music during the day, which was hard on me, and at night they would play either classic rock and roll, which is kind of what I was looking for, or preaching. My goal a lot of times was just to stay awake, and so I figured if it was good preaching, that would keep me awake, and if it was bad preaching, that would really keep me awake. I was riding back from Cleveland, Mississippi one night, and I heard the preacher talking, and he was one of those congregations so unobiscible, when the preacher would say something and everybody would respond. And he would say something, they'd say, amen. And so he's going back and forth like this, and I'm riding down the road, kind of going back and forth with him. And he says, now how many of you believe that I have five fingers on my hand? And they said, amen. He said, wait a minute. How many of you believe that I have five fingers on my hand? Hear three or four people in the background not giving up. They said, amen. He said, no, you see it. You know it. And then he quoted from the book of Hebrews, faith is the substance of things not seen. You and I are called to live in faith. You and I are called to proclaim the good news of the love of God for all of the children of God, all of the children of God. No matter what, forever and ever. I could be wrong. I believe I'm right. And at the end of this long sermon, if what you get out of this is that I am telling you that God loves you just like you are. Oh yeah, and your knee hurts and your bank account's a mess and you need to lose 10 pounds and on and on and on and on, how we give ourselves such a hard time. Loves you because you are a child of God. And all those other people that you see at Walmart, on the highway, on the TV, are also children of God. In a little bit here, I'm planning on stopping. Well, planning is not maybe hoping that I will stop. And we will continue as we reaffirm our own baptismal vows. We'll start with saying the Apostles' Creed, the old creed of the church, centuries old. And then, because it's not enough for us to just say, here's what we believe, we also need to say, and here's what we need to do about it, we have these other five questions. And they're hard questions. They're not hard because you have to make up an answer. It's will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship and the breaking of bread and the prayers? Well, what if there's a COVID-19 virus? How are we going to continue like that? What if we're scared to go out of our houses? What if the bishop's coming? You know how long he preaches.
See you. Again, I want to welcome you all here. Thank our Bishop Key for being here with us today. This wonderful opportunity to get back together for, again, a moment of honesty. February, we stop meeting. March, and the county lost big checks. I want to remind you that next Sunday we'll begin our late services in earnest. We meet here, second and fourth, just like we have every year. Second and fourth Sunday, this year that's the 14th and the 28th. We just threw in the 7th as a bonus because we have a bishop now. And I have to get a birthday present, so I can do it. Birthday present, not this moment. I'll tell you. So we'll be back here next Sunday, 12 o'clock, for service. The Church in the Pines, our regular summer service. Until at least July, we will not be meeting back inside our St. James Church building for service. Bishop will let us know how things go. Right now, it's not meeting indoors face-to-face, at least till the beginning of July. We'll reassess that, but we can have services out here at Church of the Pines. So, we got that going for us, which is nice. So next Sunday, 2 weeks from that Sunday, we'll probably do some other kind of video or something for the 21st. You know how compelling those are. We all look so forward to each and every week. I know you do like tuning in either sometime Saturday night or before Saturday night the next week. That's all I have. Finally, we do want to, is Pat Weiss here? Great. Is she? Good. Okay, so I told Gail I was going to make her come up unless Pat was here. But since Pat's here, you both have to come up for receiving a certificate for completion of EFM study program, and study will tell us just a little bit more about that. But if you ladies would please come up, it's a great honor. We'd really love to recognize this. Let's cut over where we're going.
Giving us just a minute to do this. Pat and Gail have finished 4 years of our education for ministry program.
study, 4 years? 4 years of hard study, it's longer than 7 years. You should get more than a certificate. They got, yeah, that's true. Thank you very much. And thank you, Scott, for keeping that, not being very many people in, and keeping the AFN happy with St. James. We are going to have an offertory. We're going to throw in a bonus song of Light the Fire. There will be a couple of baskets being passed around. The loose offering, undesignated, will go to the bishop's discretionary fund. So please be generous, and yeah, thanks for being here. I don't think we'll go ahead with birthday prayers. I know it's kind of our tradition, but I'm not sure what that even looks like right now. So maybe I'll just get the bishop to give a general birthday prayer.
Thank you.
with these gifts that we offer ourselves into the love and service of all. We continue with the renewal of baptismal vows. I'm asking to stand as we are made.
Bishop, I present these persons who desire to reaffirm their baptismal vows.
People of God, do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil?
I do.
Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Thank you.
Show us your mercy, O Lord. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world. Lord, keep this nation under your care. Let your way be known upon the earth. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten. Create in us clean hearts, O God.
Who shall I sing?
Bring your thanks to the band.
Glory, pour out your power and love.